Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahano Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavai, Tejasvina Vaditamastu, Mavidvishavahai, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. May the divine being look over us lovingly as a mother and father. May the divine being support and nourish us as a mother and father. May we have the strength and skill to study together the art of spirituality. May no misunderstandings arise amongst us. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto us and to all beloved beings everywhere. We are, of course, studying or reading and discussing Swami Prabhavananda's collection of talks called Realizing God. We're somewhere through the talk on silence, and the place we'll start is this. Somehow you have to still the waves of your mind, all the thoughts and distractions that are there. If they can be stilled, then the truth of God becomes revealed immediately. But this stilling of the mind is not simple or easy. For that you need spiritual disciplines. The mind has to be made pure, like crystal. Subconscious impressions have to be replaced with impressions of divinity, thinking of God all the time. Purity is thinking without any distraction and concentrating on God. When the passions are stilled and worldly desires silenced, then the word of God can be heard in the soul. Now, if you wonder, what is this? How can I achieve what he's talking about? Swami Prabhavananda did a wonderful translation and commentary on Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. The title of Swami's book is How to Know God. The title, of course, is self-explanatory. This attaining purity of mind is very well explained in the book. It begins with Patanjali's first limb of yoga, which is the yamas, the restraints. What are the restraints? Well, rather than enumerate them, let's just talk about what they are in sum. They are a turning away from the idea of I, me, mine, and the adversarial attitude toward the world that implies. I need to take care of myself and my family and so on. I need to do these things because this is the world, the way the world is, and I have to think in terms of I, me, mine. This, of course, is a constantly distracted state of mind because you're always wondering and worrying about the implications of every situation as it arises in terms of how it's going to affect you and your interests. So there is no possibility whatsoever of stilling the mind as long as one is in that frame of reference of I, me, mine. So Patanjali's next limb of yoga or step in yoga is something called the niyamas, the observances. First, we restrain ourselves. We begin the process of restraining ourselves from I, me, mine, and replace it with this, these observances. The observances are a system that Patanjali describes of there are a number of things, again, without enumerating them. In sum, they are a way of raising your awareness to the fact that there is a greater being than yourself. And in chapter 2 of Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, he explains in great detail what this replacement of the lower with the higher is. This is what the Swami said. You have to replace the distractions, thinking of God all the time. How do you get there? You need spiritual disciplines. The mind has to be pure like a crystal. Subconscious impressions have to be replaced with impressions of divinity, thinking of God all the time. Now, there is a process by which this is done and works, and it is described in chapter 2 of Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, and therefore in How to Know God. This replacement of the lower samskaras, the lower subconscious impressions, replacement where? Replacement in your awareness. It isn't that those subconscious impressions go away, but it's like a plant that you do not water. They wither. They become less prominent in your awareness, and by replacing them with the higher forms of consciousness and awareness, Swami Prabhavananda characterizes, they have to be replaced with impressions of divinity, thinking of God all the time. Now, there are many, many, many ways of thinking of God all the time. One doesn't just have to think God, God, God. Of course, there's making japam, chanting the name of the Lord and his glories. That is one way, but there are many ways. And the Swami goes into those in some detail. So I highly recommend reading that book, How to Know God. So the Swami says, purity is thinking without any distraction and concentrating on God. Well, as long as we are in that I, me, mine frame of reference, with its absolute necessity of distraction, we constantly are thinking of the world in terms of how does this affect me and my interests. So that to make progress toward self-realization, toward this silence that is at the core of our being, we must be able to still these things. So the Swami says, when the passions are stilled and worldly desires silenced, then the word of God can be heard in the soul. And this is not just a turn of phrase. The word of God is not heard necessarily. It might be heard as actual conversation, as actual words. But more than anything else, when one begins to still the passions and the distractions and the thoughts, one sinks below all of that level of activity, which is very superficial and outward directed, you sink into this space of silence, serenity, contentment. And in that, you begin to hear, feel, sense. It just depends on who you are and how you are, how it appears to you, whether you hear it or see it or feel it. It's a super sensuous way of experiencing, but you do experience it. So now, having delivered that sermonette, are there any questions or comments or anything that you'd like to contribute from your own wisdom or experience about this process? Questions, comments? All are welcome. This is studying the art of spirituality together.
This is the Harom Shankaraji.
Yes, Bala.
This is the same thing Arjuna brings up to Krishna in chapter 6. Hey, this is whatever you said, it sounds so good. But with the mind, which is what he uses the word chanchala, with distractions, it is impossible to gain it. And this is where Krishna answers, there are two things, abhyasa and vairagya.
Mm-hmm.
That is the, the essence of it is the practice of Patanjali Yoga Sutras and vairagya, dispassion.
Yes. And it requires viveka. It requires discrimination or discernment. So that when something arises in the mind that is self-centered and self, it has to do with that I, me, mine way of being, you discern that and immediately turn your attention away from that. You say, this doesn't deserve my attention. This no longer deserves my attention. I am served by something better, so I will turn my attention to that. And the mind is very clever. It's got long experience in asserting its primacy and its wisdom. So you really have to get very careful about, what is it that's in my mind? Well, how do you do this? You practice through this process of contemplation, concentration, and ultimately into meditation. You practice being the witness. That is to say, simply watching what appears in the mind. Understanding that it is all the divine. It's like Hafiz says, every thought is an innocent step on the path, no matter what the content of the thought is. It's an innocent step on the path. Why is it innocent? Because it arises from our primordial ignorance. It doesn't arise from being a bad person or being stupid or careless. All these words are just ways of limiting ourselves. No. Whatever arises in the mind is an aspect of the divine. But there are lower aspects, avidyamaya, and higher aspects, vidyamaya. So we try to move away from avidyamaya to vidyamaya. This requires discernment of the avidya maya when it arises, even in its subtle forms, and turning our attention away from that. But the only way you can really do this is by learning to be in that witness seat that says, oh, I see what's arising, and I choose not to involve myself with it. So I will turn my attention deliberately to something higher. And there's a system, as I said, within Patanjali of observances that are very congenial to that pursuit of the higher. So thank you, Bala, for bringing that up. And you're right, Krishna is very explicit about it in the Gita. Anything else from anyone?
Hello, Brother Shankara, good morning. This is Haima.
Yes.
I have a comment to make. Through meditation, years of meditation, I can see personal experiences. Calmness improves. Continuously calm mind, and you will not react to any oppositions or negative criticisms, and you don't ruminate on it. You kind of see the stillness inside. Yes. It just improves day by day, day by day. That's what my experience is.
Thank you, Haima. Exactly. That's exactly what happens. But we must practice day by day. We can't practice once a week.
Nuh-uh. And hope to make continuous.
It has to be every day. We have to generate a habit of mind, and a habit of mind requires practicing every day. It's like was said in last Sunday's talk by Henry David Thoreau. You don't make a path across the landscape by walking across it once or even once a week. No, if you walk that way across the landscape every day or virtually every day, then you develop a path. The same thing is true of the mind. Precisely the same thing is true of the mind. We develop these ways of thinking by walking, so to speak, this same way day after day, practicing over and over, which is why Sri Chaitanya says at the beginning of his prayer, chant the name of the Lord and his glory unceasingly, that the mirror of the heart may be wiped clean and quench that mighty forest fire, worldly lust, raging furiously within. This wiping of the heart clean of past impressions is gaining purity of mind, purity of heart, and the name of the Lord and his glories, the thoughts of those, if practiced day by day by day, do in fact quench this mighty forest fire, worldly lust, raging furiously within. Thank you, Haima. Anything
you,
else?
Brother.
Anything else from anyone?
Yes, Brother Shankara, a question is about the discernment, the importance of discernment. Is that like a prerequisite before we replace the higher thought?
No. This is all practiced together, dear, right from the beginning. The yamas, the niyamas, and the rest of the early phases of Patanjali's Yoga Sutra are all practiced together. It's not a prerequisite.
No.
You begin to turn away from the I, me, mine way of being. You replace it with the thou, thee, thine way of being. Through the observances. And at the same time, you are practicing whatever form of contemplation, concentration, and meditation that you are practicing. And that allows you to develop this sense of being the witness. And then you become more acute, more quick at your discernment when the mind is in its cleverness and its subtle ways, reverting to that I, me, mine way of being. And so it's not a prerequisite. It's something that happens you're doing it all together. And if you're not doing it all together, if you try to do it sequentially, it really doesn't work because there has to be something to, if you're going to replace I, me, mine with something higher, you can't just be constantly objecting to your I, me, mineness. The mind will rebel against that. Naturally, it will rebel against that. If you're going to say, I can't eat this one, then give me at least something else to eat. So you have to continue to be a part of your awareness and improve it and improve it. It's like learning anything else. You're not going to be able to fix a magnificent Thanksgiving dinner the first time you come to the cook stove. You have to learn all of the ways of cooking before you can produce a magnificent Thanksgiving dinner. Now, you don't learn that all at once, but you practice. And after a while, you know immediately the difference between a tablespoon's worth and a teaspoon's worth. You know that a scant cup is different than a cup and a half. And all of these things come to you, and you learn how to cut vegetables, and you learn how to steam them, and all these things that you learn just because you practice and practice and practice. Anyone who had never been to a cook stove before, or practically never, and tried to fix a great Thanksgiving dinner, well, you can imagine what a disaster it would be. So, no, it's practiced. We do these things together, not sequentially.
Okay. My question was about, like you said, what deserves my attention?
Yes.
And so to direct my attention on the right path, I need the discrimination before I can direct the mind, you know. So it has to be done in a conscious awareness.
No. First you do it as a practice, dear. You don't do it out of discernment. You simply do it out as a practice. This is why the niyamas are there. At the same time, you're restraining yourself from being I, me, mine centered. You are replacing it. So you don't need any discernment at that point. You're just simply doing it. You're taking a stand that all of the teachers have told me, as Bala pointed out earlier, Krishna points it out in Gita. You're just doing it. Then you, as you do the things that are recommended in the niyamas and the other practices that your teachers tell you to do, then you begin to develop the discernment. But first, you simply do it as a practice. Does that make sense?
Yes, on the whole, from the broad perspective, I agree with you. I was thinking of breaking it down, even if you're doing a practice, but in the small actions, you know, very, very small day-to-day actions.
Neera, as long as you keep saying but, as long as you keep objecting, it won't work. If you keep saying in one way or another, yes, but, it won't work. We must actually just do it. And then we see the results. If we try to think it all out beforehand, we just get lost in the forest. We lose our way. No, we just have to do it. We just have to do it. We can't reason it out first and then say, oh, I've reasoned it out. I'm persuaded I'll do it. No, you just have to do it. This is Shraddha. This is the dawn of Shraddha. Having faith that what Patanjali said, what Vasishta said, what Shankara said, what Chaitanya said, what Sri Ramakrishna said, what Krishna said, what all these people have said has great power in it. So if I go ahead with that, as they tell me to do it, and stop reading more books, stop listening to more lectures, just do it. Because reasoning it out will not get us there. As Einstein so succinctly pointed out, one cannot solve a problem with the mind that created it. So we have to attain purity of mind, which is what the Swami says, is necessary to hear the words of God in the soul. The mind and the soul seemingly being two different things. They're not really, but they're just two aspects of the same thing. But in the beginning, we have to see them as separate. Yes,
I agree with you that while I'm practicing, I am doing my daily practice, but still, you know, the mind goes off during, when once you've done, you know, you're on the path. And then you have to have some kind of, so you can go either right or left, you know, that direction. And
as you say. Thank you. Anyone else? Anything from anyone else?
Hi, Brother Shankara, Samesh here.
Yes, Samesh.
Shankara, I feel like I've cheated myself that I come to these, these gatherings, but I didn't put any practice, to be honest. And now I feel like I'm at a place where I'm just getting more knowledge, which is not adding. Just like you said, you can read all the books, you can do all the things. It doesn't make a difference. And I want to be clear that when you are talking about this practice, you're talking about start using instead of me, myself, I, thee, thine. That's what you're talking, or like, what exactly are we talking in the practice here? And I want to put that in place.
So just read the niyamas. Just get a good translation. Swami Prabhavananda's is an excellent one. Mm-hmm. Swami Vivekananda's, it's in his complete works, Raja Yoga. I think you have a PDF copy of the complete works. Just read what is said about the niyamas.
Okay.
It's a very elegant little system, and it is meant to replace what you are restraining yourself from doing. Now, about what you said, so sincerely and sweetly, Somesh, that you're come to these gatherings, but you're not doing much in the way of practice. Don't worry so much about that. As Sri Ramakrishna says, everything happens at the right time. You clearly have the motivation. There is the spark of the desire to escape limitation. That's what liberation means. Liberation means escaping all limitation, including the limitation of having to take human birth. But until we have strong motivation, there won't be daily practice. So don't despair about it. Don't concern yourself over much. Just blow on that spark as best you can by coming to these classes, by reading what you can, by listening to what you can. I have a recommendation for what to listen to. So many people listen to Swami Sarvapriyananda. Sarvapriyananda is absolutely glorious, splendid. But Sarvapriyananda is talking, generally speaking, about the highest, the highest. He doesn't speak to people necessarily where they start from. One of the great speakers of this tradition that does allow us to hear things from our place, because he says it in different ways, even within the same talk, he says it in this different ways for the different, so to speak, levels of understanding that are available to him in the audience. And that is Swami Sridharananda, Sridhar, Sridharananda, Sridharananda. He's in charge of the Vedanta Society of Sydney, Australia, and also he's in charge of the work in New Zealand. But you can find any number of his talks online. I suggest you start with his talks on the Gita and start at the beginning, and you know, there are many, many talks, many, many talks. Just listen to one a day, if you can spend that time. And I think you'll find, if you do, that this spark of motivation, of zeal, of mumukshatvam that is awakened in you will grow. Swami Sridharananda is one of the great masters of this tradition and one of the best speakers I've ever sat in the presence of. I had the great privilege of actually being in his presence before he was no longer able to travel. So Swami Sridharananda.
Sure. Thank you so much. I will listen to him. And also, thank you for saying that, you know, don't beat yourself up on not.
Oh, please, please, Sumesh.
That relaxes me quite a lot. having said that.
There's no reason for you to be anything but glad that this has awakened in you. And when it does awaken in us, then some other things begin to happen, all in their good time. We can encourage them by doing things like listening to Sridharananda, listening to Sarvapriyananda for that matter. It's just that many of us, Swami Sarvapriyananda, is as true as what he says is, he's speaking over many devotees' heads because he's been speaking about this so long. It isn't that he doesn't understand that there are various levels. It's just that his inclination is to speak of the highest. And I certainly understand that. And, but I mean, if you listen to his talk on moksha, for example, which you can find online, I mean, it is not, it's not going to go down easy for someone who's new to this path.
Okay, got it. No, I'll listen to Swami Sridharananda.
Sridharananda, yes. Vedanta Society of Sydney. That's what you would. You can just go on YouTube and Google Swami Sridharananda for that matter. But I hope that you find the beginning of his class on the Gita, which he's given many times. There's a series of recordings. He's just masterful. Anyone else, anything?
Brother Shankara?
Yes, dear.
This is Swayam.
Yes, Swayam.
When my mind and body place obstacles in front, in this path, what helps me are, one is Shraddha. I just try to remember, you know, the scriptures, the sages, and so many have achieved, and I will get there one day. And other one is living sacramentally, which you have always recommended. So mine goes haywire, but I try to offer it. And then that...
Exactly, Swayam. When the mind goes haywire, offer that too. This mind does not belong to us. That's what the scriptures tell us over and over. Brahman is the ear of the ear, the eye of the eye, the speech of the speech, the thoughts of the mind. So yes, living sacramentally, perfect. When the mind goes haywire, offer that too. I'm sorry I interrupted you, but I didn't want to let that go by because it was so perfectly said. Anything more, dear?
No, that's actually all I wanted to share. Thank you.
The fact that you, these are the two components of mamukshutva, Shraddha and the practice of living life sacramentally. This is what Sri Krishna says in chapters 5 and 6 of the Gita. Just offer it all to me. Offer it all to me, without limitation, without exception, without reservation. Everything. Offer it all to him. If you read the list, I believe it's in chapter 5, the list of things, he tries to be exhaustive so that you don't need to feel like there's anything to be left out. Thank you, Swayam. Anything else from anyone?
Brother Shankara?
Yes.
Hariom.
Hariom.
Two items. One, Swami Sridharananda Ji, quite some time ago, you said that he was not feeling well. Can you give any short update how he's doing now?
Swami Sridharananda?
Yes.
You'll have to look on the website, the Sydney website. I honestly don't know what his current health situation is. He's in his mid-80s. And of course, the Stardust spacesuit is beginning to come to pieces, as it does with all of us. So I don't know what his situation is.
Also, one comment, please. Speaking of Abhyas, Vairagya, and Viveka, sometime, especially lately, in the puja room or otherwise, my mind is not at peace. It goes every which way. And at that time, yes, what you said earlier and today also, reminding myself, does this deserve my attention? That helps a whole lot. And another thing that has helped me is asking myself, have I done enough Viveka? And that stops the mind from where it was.
This having not done enough Viveka, this is discernment. You know, never accuse yourself of not having done enough. You just say, well, that's what's been the case. So now I'll go on from here. Always think of yourself positively. By nature, you are this purity, this glory. It is only covered by ignorance. The ignorance is primordial and is no more our own than anything else. It's not my ignorance. It's not my gunas that are the instruments of the ignorance. It's not my anything. It is all the work and creation of the divine. Mother, as expressed in the Chandi, is and does and creates everything. And so we must never feel inadequate or wrong or bad about being ignorant. It is our primordial condition. And what are we doing? We're doing our best to dispel it by sitting in classes like this, by doing the practices that classes like this encourage us to do. Thank you, Vijay.
Thank you.
Anything else from anyone? Okay. To go on with what the Swami wrote and said. We have to change our whole mode of living, not by giving up duties, but by changing our whole attitude. Think of God, feel the presence of God. If you feel that presence, you are bathed in His light. Now, you may not be a person who feels. You may hear, you may see. There are all of the outward directed ways of sensing the organs of perception. They have a subtle form and they have a psychic form. The psychic form. Swami Prabhavananda used to say, sometimes when I say my mantra, I get this wonderful scent. He would actually smell the presence of the divine. And he wasn't speaking metaphorically. He wasn't speaking extravagantly. He meant it. Sometimes when he would think certain thoughts that arose because of his practices, he would get this scent, this unbelievably strong and beautiful scent that was just another form of the divine presence's beauty as experienced by our psychic senses. And of course, that then transforms into superconscious experience of the divine. The superconscious experience is the one that you have in Savikalpa Samadhi, and then the total where superconsciousness is all that is, of course, in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. But in the meantime, when he says, if you feel that presence, so you can hear that presence, you can see that presence, you can hear that presence, you can smell that presence. I suppose in a way you could even taste that presence. I haven't ever heard anyone say so, but that doesn't mean it hasn't happened. Think of God, feel the presence of God. So I'm going to replace the word feel. If you sense that presence, you are bathed in its light. This is one of the first vows we take. I will not brood over my past mistakes when I go to meditate, when I go to think of God. I'll think myself pure, free, divine. Now that is a very potent instruction. As a matter of fact, it's one that if you take initiation, it's one of the first instructions. Think of yourself as free, pure, divine. That is your true original nature. Everything else is a upadhi, a limitation, a form of ignorance. So I will not brood over my past mistakes. Of course not. What can you do about your past mistakes? You can learn from them as best you can and then let them go. As Swami Swahananda would say, what's done is done. Go forward. And so don't think about them. Of course they'll come to mind. Of course they will come to mind. This is when, as the Swami says here, what deserves your attention? No, I am not those past mistakes. I am that pure, free, divine presence. That is who I truly am. All the rest of this is just the being and doing in ignorance that has happened in the past. So when I go to meditate, I will not brood over my past mistakes. I will think of God. I'll think myself pure, free, divine. What sincere seeking means, in a word, is to go into silence where there is cessation of all desires. When the mind is eager, waiting for God's grace comes immediately. Somehow I got that wrong. When the mind is eager, waiting for God, I missed the comma. When the mind is eager, waiting for God, grace comes immediately. But we bring the mind into that condition of waiting, eager. It is in silence that the truth of God is imparted through the grace of a guru or teacher. What does he mean? The guru may speak with you, may give you instructions, may walk with you, talk with you, but it is what is happening in the silence that really is what is transformative for you. It is that feeling that you get by being in the presence of a real teacher, that this is possible for me too. So it awakens or strengthens your Shraddha, your sense that this is not just for others, it is for me too. And this is where true happiness lies. It is in the silence. It is in silence that the truth of God is imparted through the grace of a guru or teacher. Now, as you sit for concentration, and meditation, over time, the guru, God alone is the guru, in fact. It has these personalities that teach us, but you begin to hear and be taught by the divine presence itself. Sri Ramakrishna was asked once, where is God? He put a cloth in front of his face and said, you see, God is there, but you can't see him because of this veil. That is the veil of ignorance. And that's all that separates us. And it is primordial. It comes with time, space, and causation. It comes with Maya. And so we must not be anything more than anxious, eager, waiting for that veil to be dispelled, for that veil to be either disintegrated or I can't talk now, I'm in class. I'll call you back. And that's what spiritual practices do. It takes away that veil of ignorance. Just try to understand this simple truth, the Swami says. The cloth in front of his face is all that kept people from seeing Sri Ramakrishna in that moment, who was, of course, the Divine Presence, if you choose to believe it along with us. So Sri Ramakrishna was asked once, where is God? He put his cloth in front of his face and said, you see, God is there, but you can't see him because of this veil. That is the veil of ignorance. Just try to understand this simple truth. Even though there is the veil of ignorance and we do not see him, still try to feel that he is nearer than hands and feet. He is the very consciousness of your being conscious. That's what I meant earlier by saying Brahman is the ear of the ear, the eye of the eye, the thought of the thinking. He is the very consciousness of our being conscious. You are that simply because you are aware of being conscious, but you don't know it because of the veil of ignorance. With spiritual growth, as you practice spiritual disciplines, the first understanding that comes is the isness of God. He is. He is. I don't see him. I don't know him yet, but he is. This conviction comes, but only when we rend asunder this veil of ignorance. This conviction comes, but only when we rend asunder this veil of ignorance. And that doesn't happen immediately for most of us. It can happen, as it happened to Scrooge in the story of A Christmas Carol. That can happen, Swami Prabhavananda said. But for most of us, it's a lengthy process. So before we go on, anything else that anyone wants to offer in the way of comment from their own wisdom or any question or concern that they'd like to raise? We have a few minutes left. Yes.
I have no difficulty at all with Shraddha being able to bring the picture or vision of Thakur in front of me anytime. But I have a great difficulty thinking of myself as I am that.
That
meaning capital T.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter how much I remind myself, I'm not this body, I still remain confined to the concept of I am and he is.
Mm-hmm. So be it. When the right time comes, that will continue to be, it'll change to he is and I am. In the meantime, you just have to ask yourself, what's the payoff for me of remaining in this state? There has to be a payoff. We have to like it for some reason. Now, I can say to you personally and directly as an artist, it is difficult to see and be that, because one has this feeling as an artist that this creation of the art is, at least I am the instrument. So I am the instrument and he is the one that the operator of this instrument. But in the moment, in the creation of our being and doing, it seems like that is what comes first. So be it. As that short poem says, being, creating, doing, sharing, the joys of these is why we're here. When you are truly tired of this, just sign off and head for home. But you have to be truly tired of it. You have to be truly tired of it. You're not going to sign off and head for home if you're still getting joy from it. So admit, I get joy from being the way I am. But Lord, take me further. Take me by the hand, pull me on, draw me near, fill this heart. Just pray the devotee's prayer. Lord, take me by the hand, pull me on. My mind is wayward. So you are the author of everything. You pull me on. You draw me near. This is my prayer. And ultimately, fill this heart, and then I will understand you are, and sort of, I am, as a part of that. Does all that make sense, Vijay?
Yes, a whole lot, and especially when you related the topic to art, yes, it's extremely often in my case that when I'm writing a poem, for those moments, if it takes 20 minutes or a half hour, or whatever time it takes, I am not in touch with myself at all. It's as if something has taken me over.
Yes. And if you could write a poem in 20 minutes or half an hour, you are a master poet.
That's just the beginning only. And sometimes it takes hours and hours to finish one poem just because I'm not satisfied.
First there comes the inspiration, as you said, something takes you over. And this happens to all of us because we're all artists. We're all artists of our own life. We'll find that there are those moments where, as musicians say, you're in the zone, or you just said, something takes me over. We all have those experiences. But then as an artist, what happens when you have that inspiration? Then there is the left mind practice of craft. How do I bring this to something that I can share with others? So then these are the two aspects. So being, creating, doing, and sharing. Well, almost all of us wish to share ourselves, share our lives, share our experiences with others. And some do it as a discipline and this they move then from a more ordinary way of communicating with one another to this artistic way of communicating. And it's just another, there's nothing different about it except in degree. There's a desire to make it something that has this little explosion effect when the other person hears it, whether it be music or poetry. Or, and if you want to know what I mean by music, just listen to Beethoven's the last movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Ode to Joy. I mean, it is an explosion of joy. Beethoven just releases this explosion of joy. But such craft, you know, he's just such a master musician. So, thank you, Vijay. Anything else from anyone?
Brother Shankara, just one moment, please.
Yes.
I was going to use the same word in my mind, the word explosion, when you said about the last movement of Beethoven's Ninth.
Yes.
It really is explosion, like on 4th of July, you see in the sky when there are fireworks and you see them all over.
Ah,
that's what it is.
Yes.
And the second thought I want to share and ask for your opinion on that is, at times I have asked myself, if I have Shraddha and if I have the feeling of I am and he is, so long as I am in that bhakti mode, do I really need to strive to go beyond that to any different realm?
It's your choice purely, Vijay. There's no need. There's nothing, no dogma whatsoever. None. There's no need to do it. Do you want to do it? If you don't want to do it, if you're not truly tired of being in that frame of reference of I am and he is, if you're not tired of that, I mean, Tukaram put it so comically and beautifully when he said, only a fool would kick a lover out of bed unless he knew he had two more better on the way. I mean, this is Tukaram's poem, or part of a poem by Tukaram. So we're not going to give up being who we are until we're truly convinced that there's a greater payoff in the next level. And the levels are, we start as the feeling of I am. That's self-evident. That's a given. Each one of us right here, who of us will say, I am not? No, of course not. Well, that would just be utter foolishness. So we start off, this is Swami Sridharananda's formulation, by the way. We start off with this self-evident idea, our experience and our understanding, I am. Then something dawns in us that beyond us there's something greater. However it happens to us, some experience, some moment will convince us that there is something beyond ourselves. Something beyond the simple I am. So then it becomes I am and he or she, if it's the Divine Mother, I am and she or he is. Then over time, if we practice that thought of she or he is in its various ways, we see that everything comes from that. So then the formulation in our mind is, she or he is, and therefore I am. After a time we see, and this is seeing isn't even really the right word anymore, because there's no seer there, but we return, if we return from the experience of the highest samadhi, to say, as Sri Ramakrishna said, as Krishna says, as Jesus said, he alone or she alone is. And there's no question of there being any part. It is purna. It is perfect. It is complete. You can't take it apart. Any taking apartness is ignorance. But not to feel at any time that ignorance is bad, wrong. It just becomes less and less convenient to be ignorant. It just becomes less and less convenient. And so we dispel it. Anything else from anyone? All right, dears.
I just want to say one word.
Please.
Sri Ramakrishna says, especially in the teachings of the householders, he says the same thing. You know, it is very difficult to say, I am that. That's why his advice is, take the servant attitude.
Yes.
I am, you are the master. I am the servant.
Exactly. Yes, he highly recommends the Dasya Bhava, yes. the servant attitude. He says, Be a handmaid in the master's house. The handmaid says, oh, our house, my Hari, you know, she knows perfectly well that she's a person of a village far away, and that none of this is hers. But if we take that attitude, this is the miracle. If we take that attitude, then the master begins to appear to us. If we really live and serve in that attitude, the master begins to appear to us. Where? In the heart. As Sri Ramakrishna says, the master may be found at any time somewhere on his estate, but he's most often found in his drawing room. The heart is the drawing room of God. And so when we have this attitude of master and servant, then the master becomes more real to us. And this is the I am and he is. And after a while, we see, well, it's only because he is that I am here as the servant. So that's how that switch comes. Thank you, Bala. That was just right. Anything else, dears? All right. Om Asato Ma Satkamaya. Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya. Mrityor Ma Amrutangamaya. Abir Abir Maiti. O dearly beloved Lord, lead us from this realm of noisy confusion and delusion to thine abode of serenity, silence, and clarity. Lead us from darkness and ignorance to the brilliance of thy wisdom and love. Lead us from death to immortality. Light us through and through, light us through and through with thy everlasting, shining presence. Jai Shri Guru Maharaj Ki Jai, Durga Durga Durga. May we be safe, may we be healthy, may we have peace of mind. May we go forward in the mother's loving and protective embrace. So, tomorrow morning, we will talk about the karma yoga of the Baal Shem Tov. The Baal Shem Tov was a 17th century Jewish saint. As Swami Vivekananda said, the true test of a religion's depth is its capacity to produce saints. And of course, Judaism has produced many, many saints, including Christ. And we forget that Judaism gave birth to Christ. Christ said, it is you, speaking to the Jews. You called me forth. I am the Son of Man. Of course, he wasn't limiting it to the Jews, but he was speaking to the Jews. So the Baal Shem Tov is a truly remarkable saint. And much of what he taught we will recognize immediately as the karma yoga that was taught thousands of years before by Sri Krishna. But it doesn't mean it isn't just as new and just as real to the Baal Shem Tov as the divine presence taught it to him, as it was to Arjuna when Krishna taught it to Arjuna. And so beautifully the Baal Shem Tov voices it in a way that still really rings true in our hearts. So the karma yoga of the Baal Shem Tov, and the reason for that particular talk at this particular time is that Monday is the beginning of Hanukkah, the celebration of a great event in the lives of the Jewish people, and the day of the lighting of the first candle of the menorah. Any final thought from any of you? Anything else that anyone would like to say at this beginning of the last days of the holy season? The holy season has been going on for some time, of course, beginning with the mother's worship. But now with Thanksgiving, we start what we can regard as the Western aspects of our holy days. Thanksgiving was should be regarded as a holy day, and now there are many more. Those of you who know the Christian faith at all know that now is the dawn of the beginning of the Advent calendar, the Advent being, of course, the Advent of Christ. And so the holy days will go on through the 12 days of Christmas. The 12 days of Christmas start on December the 24th and end on January the 6th. That being the tradition is, that's when the wise men, the three wise men who came to offer their gifts and adoration to Jesus, left to return home. So that's what we'll be observing over the next 6 weeks or so. So, anything else?
Well, it is, even according to the Hindu things, this month is very auspicious, which is Kartika Masa.
Yes.
So, tomorrow is the last day at the Hindu temple. They have been doing for the 9 days, propitiate Lakshmi.
Aha. Or the goddess of all good fortune.
Yes. Tomorrow is the last day.
Yes, but that doesn't mean she's going anywhere.
No. At least the celebration at the temple would be the last day.
Yes. but she will be with us through these holy days.
Yes.
And the Divine Mother, we think of good fortune and so on in worldly terms, but what good fortune is it that the avatars are born to us, and they're born of the Divine Mother? In the case of Christianity, Sweet Mother Mary. And Sweet Mother Mary is Holy Mary, Mother of God, the Lord is with thee. And so we will on Christmas Eve, of course, we'll invite someone to sing that Ave Maria for us. Unfortunately, we won't be meeting in person. I don't think it'll be timely yet for us to meet in person by Christmas Eve, which is, for me, a sadness. It was a sadness that we couldn't meet on Thanksgiving and start our holy days that way, these holy days. All right, dears. Thank you, Bala. Anything else? Thank you for reminding us about that. Anything else from anyone?
Well, the last thing that comes to my mind is the news from yesterday about the new variant of COVID-19.
Oh, yes.
I don't know where it's going to take us. Supposed to leave for India on Monday, but I postponed completely.
Thank you for doing that, Bala. We don't want to lose you. Yes, I think the World Health Organization, have they named it Omicron or something like
yes.
that?
Yes.
And so, yes, there's a new variant. It arose apparently in South Africa. And so...
today's news, actually... the first case in UK was identified. Right now they have in Hong Kong, Belgium, Israel, and now UK.
Yeah. Well, as it says in the Chandi, Mother multiplies her own form into many.
Yeah.
In order to destroy the Asuras and to restore righteousness. So this is this is Mother multiplying her own form into many. That's one way to see it. But of course it also says, Mother, don't you destroy Asuras by mere sight, yet you direct your weapons against them. so that even the inimical ones, purified by the missiles, may attain the higher worlds. Such is your most kindly intention toward them. All are her children. The asuras, the daityas, and the devas, and all jiva, all of jiva, all of that which breathes. So it gives us reason for compassion, even toward those people who are leaving this relative plane because of the COVID. I'm really glad you canceled your trip, Bala. It would have been too risky.
Yes.
So we just have to be, we just have to continue to practice kinds of isolation. And it of course, it too is an opportunity for us to grow.
Yes.
Because it eliminates forms of distraction that we might otherwise practice. So until tomorrow morning, for those of you who decide to join us, any final thought from anyone else? Thank you, Bala.
Thank you, sir. Hari Om.
Hari Om, Hari Om. And so until tomorrow morning, Jai Ma, Jai Ma, Jai Ma.
Thank you, Brother Shankara.
Thank you, dears.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.